welcome to the Eastside Church of Christ, where we're going to have a hallelujah good time this morning. This morning, I will be speaking a sermon entitled Where the Seeds Fall, where I will go in and analyze the parable of the seeds in Mark chapter 4, and we'll go through the wayside, we'll go through the stony ground, the thorns, and eventually the good ground, and hopefully I'll pull something from it that will be prosperous in your life, and hope you enjoy it.
To me, God has heard, sower to sow. And it came to pass, as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and the fowls of the air came and devoured it up. And some fell on stony ground, where it had not much earth, and immediately it sprang up, because it had no depth of earth. But when the sun was up, it was scorched, and because it had no root, it withered away. And some fell upon thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no fruit. And others fell on good ground, and did yield fruit that sprang up and increased, and brought forth some 30, some 60, and some 100. Let the Lord bless the ears and the ears of his holy word.
Thank you. Thank you. crowd, so many loved ones, so many, so much family, so many family, so many friends that have poured into me and given me to where I am today. It is, I'm looking at you all and I'm seeing faces that without you all,
with that being said, it's almost as if the kingdom was hidden.
right? So when you think about what a parable is, we always say it is a earthly story with a heavenly meaning. But I can say that in this context, that is an earthly story with a hidden heavenly meaning that only certain people can understand. And all parable is, it comes from the Greek word parabola. And basically, when you sum up all of its different definitions, it turns out to be a comparison, a metaphor, meaning that it's comparing two things, which means that you see one thing in order to get the full gravity of the parable, you have to see both things. You can't just look at what he's saying and just take it for what it is. It's a different meaning. So my goal for this morning is that we can really understand that second meaning, that heavenly meaning that's in this. So let's go through and let's read this the rest of what he has to say. Verse 13. And he said unto them, know ye not this parable? How then will ye know all parables? The sower soweth the word. And these are they by the wayside where the word was sown. But when they have heard, Satan cometh immediately and taketh away the word that was sown in their hearts. And these are they likewise which were sown, which are sown on stony ground, who when they have heard the word, immediately receive it with gladness, and have no root in themselves, and so endure but for a time. Afterward, when affliction or persecution arises, for the word's sake, immediately they are blessed. And these are which are sown among thorns, such as hear the word, and the cares of this world, and the deceitfulness of riches, and the lust of other things entering in choke the word, and becometh unfruitful. And these are they which are sown on good ground, such as hear the word and receive it, and bring forth fruit, some 30-fold, some 60-fold, and some 100. So Jesus gives us the answers to this parable. So there's really nothing new that I'm going to bring out this morning, but instead try to explain it and try to give it a deeper meaning. So it's interesting to me. We always say you have to be rooted and grounded in the word. But in this parable, the word is the seed. So instead, the seed being the word has to be rooted and grounded in us. The seed is what's being, the seed is the word. And so if the seed is the word, then the environments are us, or our hearts, the hearts of the people. So instead of us being rooted and grounded in the word is what has to be rooted and grounded in us. It's what has to grow in us. It's what has to grow in our hearts. So I just feel like that's really interesting. That's really important to understand as we go through this parable. So first, wayside, verse 15. And I picture a farmer who's walking through his path in his field, and he has seeds in his hand, and he's throwing it out. They don't have any seed or anything. Like, this is like first century AD or whatever. Like, they didn't have that technology. So they're just throwing out seed. And as he's throwing out seed, of course he's going to have some that fall through the cracks of his hands and on the path of his feet. All the wayside is just the path that he's walking on through his field. So these seeds land on the path that he's walking on. But because he walks on that path so often, the soil with it is packed together. It's packed hard. It's hardened. It's hardened soil. And so the seed is not able to embed itself in the soil. So it's exposed. It's not protected. And because it's exposed and not protected, the fowls of the air are able to devour it, and it never brings forth fruit. The soil on the wayside is hardened. So the people who represent the wayside are hardened people. Their hearts are hardened. These are the people who aren't trying to hear the word. These are the people who won't be able to receive it. And these come in the form of people who have been hurt a lot. These are the people who have been stabbed in the back, who have been taken advantage of, who have known nothing but evil their whole lives. And so they learn not to trust anything. They learn not to trust anything that they see. So when you ask them to trust into something they can't see, they're like, are you crazy? I've been stabbed by the back by my best friend 5 times. Like, how am I supposed to believe in a force that I can't even see? They can't trust it. When you tell them that there's another way, when you tell them that evil is not the way, it is not the only way, they don't know what you're talking about because that's all they've seen. That's all they've known their entire lives. And then you have the other side of people who have just lived worldly lives their entire life. You have people who all they know is worldliness. And so when you tell them fornication is a sin, they're like, no, not for me, not for me. That's not for me. When you hear it, you have to forgive your brother 70 times in a day. They're like, no, I can't. I can't forgive so-and-so for what they did to me 10 years ago. I can't. That's just not for me. And so you have these people who have let the world tell them how to live their life. And so when they hear anything contrary to the way they've been living their life, they're not receptive to it because they're saying, so I've been living my life wrong. So I'm the one that's wrong. They're hardened. All that time that they've spent either allowing things to hurt them or living that worldly life has hardened them. And so they're not able to receive the word. And so the word, the seed that is the word, is not able to penetrate their hearts. And when it's not penetrating their hearts, it's not protected. The way we protect the word is by embedding it in our hearts. The devil can penetrate everything outside of us. The devil can penetrate what we have, what we own, the people, even the people around us. But he can't penetrate our hearts if we don't let him. But because the word is not embedded in these wayside people's hearts, it's not protected. So the vows of the year for Satan will snatch it away. And because nothing is filling that heart, the word isn't filling that heart, nothing else will take its place. And that's just worldliness, and that's just Satan taking advantage of empty space. An example of this would be Pharaoh in ancient Egypt. When I think about it from Pharaoh's perspective, his daddy's daddy owned the children of Israel. They owned the Hebrews, right? So if you're raised under generations and generations of owning these people, you think this is the way it should be. And so when this random exile who hasn't been in the city for 40 years plus comes back with the word of the Lord saying, "Free, let my people go," he's like, "What? This is how we do things." And so the Bible really says he hardened his heart to the word of the Lord. And it took plague after plague after plague after plague until he finally just said, "Y'all can have it. You can have it." And then even after that, he chased them and went after them because he was so hung up on how things were before him. So he hardened his heart to God's word, and because of that, not only did his people pay the price, but he also paid the price as well. So then we have a stony ground. And in verse 16, let's paint the picture of the stony ground. So we have soil. It's great topsoil. It looks good. But under it, you have a big rock or big rocks. But the verse says, immediately it springs up. Why is it? Well, if we look into the science of it, stones carry heat. And early on in a seed's life, that heat is what makes it grow. And so because the stone carries a lot more heat than the soil itself would, it springs up a lot faster. Because all heat is kinetic energy, and then you get germination from that and all that. It's a lot of science. So it ends up growing fast, but when it's time to actually grow roots, so if you have a great foundation, the stone blocks it. So the very thing that caused it to grow so fast is the thing that caused its demise. Stony people have shallow hearts. The verse says they are the ones who hear the word with gladness and are only there but for a time. These are the people who hear the word and receive it with gladness and abide in the word because it feels good. Because they like how it feels. They're wide, the reason why their ear is off. So as long as they're feeling good, as long as we're coming here singing songs, as long as everything is right in their life, they're good. And these might even be some of the most productive members in our churches. But as soon as things don't feel good anymore, as soon as the persecution and trials arise, when it's time to end those relationships, when it's time to let those people go, when rumors begin to be spread about you, that is when these people want to reap the benefits of Christ, but do not want to accept the consequences that come with it. These people want resurrection without the death. These people want the promised land without Egypt. They want to skip. They want to pick and choose. They don't want to pay the price that Jesus had to pay. They don't want to pay the price that Paul had to pay. Remember, Paul was locked up for years, and he was eventually executed. But we don't like to look at that. These stony people look at verses like when Jesus told us he will give us rest. They look at verses like I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And that type of power and that type of access to Christ excites them. It excites them. But because they're only here because of how they feel, they're only here before time. Because we all know that while Jesus was very popular in the first half of his life, the second half of his ministry was not so, that people were not so receptive of his word. And people don't want, and the stony people are not able to accept that part of Christianity. So an example I see of this are the children of Israel. Staying with the story of the Exodus, they had prayed for that for hundreds of years and praised to God for to be free. So when they finally got freed, they were excited. They were excited. They were like, yeah, we'll follow Moses wherever he goes. And then they get to the wilderness. Mm-hmm. And then their lifestyle has to change. Mm-hmm. And then they have to eat manna, and they get tired of eating manna. And eventually, because they have to shift their lifestyle, because things aren't the same as they were, because they have to give up some things, they leave God. And they end up disobeying God and the words from God from Moses, and they ended up staying in the wilderness for 40 years because they left the word. Now, we get to the thorns. The seeds that land with the thorns land on the ground. The ground, there's nothing wrong with the ground with the thorns, because how else would the thorns be able to grow? But the problem is the fact that the seed has to compete with the thorns in order to grow. And because there's so many thorns, and the thorns are so far into their maturation process, they choke the seed out. Seed is not able to bear forth fruit. Thorny people, there's nothing wrong with their hearts. There's nothing wrong with their hearts. If anything, their heart is clear to a fault because they let too much stuff in. These thorny people, when the word gets in their hearts, it has to compete against other stuff. These are the people who are constantly looking for something to fill that void in their life. These are the people who are constantly scrolling through social media wanting what everybody else has. These are the people wishing that they had what their neighbor had. Or even, these are the people, because it mentioned also the cares of this earth, these are the people who are maybe struggling financially. This is the single mom with two or three kids and a barely over minimum wage paying job, and she has to worry about that. It gets hard for your spirit to breathe when you're going through something like that. It gets hard for the spirit to breathe when you're looking around and everybody has, but you don't. It gets hard to breathe when you're constantly comparing yourself to other people.
Yeah, all right.
It gets hard to breathe when you're in that spirit. And so, since it's so easy to get caught up in the rat race of this world, the word tends to take a back seat. And eventually, the thorns, the worries, the wants of this world overshadow and make the word unstable. You don't bear any fruit. And I wish I had time. Well, actually, I do. Nor yet for your body, what ye shall put on, is not life more than meat, and the body more than raiment? Behold, fowl of the earth, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns. Yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not as much better than they? Which of you by taking thought can add one cubit to a stature? And why I take ye thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you, even Solomon, in all his glory, was not arrayed like one of these. So this is coming straight from the source, Jesus. And we know that Jesus never sinned when he was on this earth, so we know that he never lied. He is literally telling these people, do not worry for your life. Do not worry for the bare necessities of life, no matter how hard it seems, no matter how much the bills start to pile up. Do not worry about your life, because if the fowls of the air and the lilies of the field have everything that they need, surely you, our most prized creation, made in the image of your own God, will have the things that you need. This is coming from the source. And I understand that it's so easy to get caught up with what's in front of us and the trials that face us, but God has never failed us. Not even once. We are the ones who fail him and thus fail ourselves. So if you're not able to let go, and if you're not able to believe what Jesus is saying, that seems like a personal problem. That seems like a faith problem. Because we know that Jesus is not a liar. We know that he will take care of it. And in the end, these thorny people allow the proximity of the temporary to block out the finality of eternity. They allow the proximity of the temporary to block out the finality of eternity. Because they get so caught up in this life. But little do they understand that this life is but a vapor. It is temporary. Where you spend eternity is forever. And an example I can find in this would be King Solomon. This here is one of the wisest men to ever live on this earth. All of billions of people who have lived on this earth, he is one of the wisest men on this earth, and he fell victim to this. So he was a king, and so he had a lot of stuff, namely a lot of women, a lot of foreign women. And so he allowed these foreign women of different religions and of different backgrounds to turn his heart away from God. The thorns choked out the seed that was the word, and thus the word didn't bear forth any fruit. And I know if this can happen to one of the wisest men to ever walk this earth, I know that this can happen to pretty much any of us. So finally, he spends all this time talking about all these three scenarios where seeds don't bear forth. And we finally get to the good one. Three out of four environments have seeds who bear forth no fruit. But the good ground, that one, there's nothing wrong with it. The seeds were able to get down the soil and grow freely, grow full, complete, and they were able to bear forth fruit. And the verses say, some 30-fold, some 60-fold, some 100. So if we're going from a proportion, only 25% of the field bear fruit. But the fruit that they bear was so much greater than the losses that occurred. So 30, 60, and 100. And then those fruit can bear seeds that can plant more fruit. The seeds that land on the good ground is not about how many seeds land on good ground, but it's about the production that they can give. And so, the good ground, it says, are the people who receive the word, who hear the word, receive it, and then bear forth fruit. These are the doers. These are the people who allow the word to grow in them and thus transform them. And then the fruit has no choice but to bear. The fruit has no choice but to grow when you allow the word to go into your heart and grow. You have no choice but to bear forth fruit. And don't get it twisted. Fruit does not the magnitude of the membership, but it's what the members can do. It's the magnitude of action. God, I really do believe this. God would rather take three committed Christians than 3,000 people playing church. He would rather take three good souls who are allowing the word to grow in them and are thus putting out more good energy and are bearing fruit than 3,000 people who are just playing church. Because 3,000 people who are just playing church are not going to bear forth any fruit. Because they're not, their understanding of the word is surface level. They're not able, those roots are not strong enough to bring forth the nutrients to bear that fruit. And so, let's not get discouraged when we see people walk in and out of these doors. We've seen it for years now. We've seen people go down in the water and then leave. We see this year after year after year after year after year. But let's not get discouraged. Even if our membership goes down to 45 people, as long as we let the word germinate in our spirit and grow, 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold, the potential that this group of people has, and all Christians have, is way more important than the numbers that we're losing, because they're either the wayside, or the stony ground, or the homeless. So, when I was reading, it just kind of hit me hard a little bit, because I was reading these verses and I kind of saw some of myself at times, right? And so one last point I would like to make is we, even us in the body, replicate these environments. A lot of us have been going. In fact, if we're being real, probably all of us have been going. All of us have let the words choke out the word so that we don't bear forth in the harvest. A lot of us have been stoning. A lot of us have not claimed him when the heat was going and just dropped him and just hid in the shadows. And even some of us have been hard. Even some of us are still nice, receptive of some parts of the word. And we understand that Jesus wants us to accept all of what he says, not just some. Because then that makes us incomplete. And he doesn't want an incomplete vessel. So that being said, I just want to ask you this morning, when you look at your life, what environments do you see? Is it all people around? Probably not. If I'm being real with myself, it's not. So I just want us to think about that, and I want us to, whenever we look at this parable, whenever we read this parable, to understand that while this is applying to people who are hearing the word for the first time and new converts, it applies to us as well. But even in our unfruitfulness, I'm grateful that we serve a God that gives us more to see. I'm grateful that we have a God that gives us the ability to constantly receive his word, and that constantly throws out seeds to us, so that we can have a chance to get our environments right, that we can get a chance to have our hearts right. I'm thankful that we live in an age of grace where even in our unfruitful nature, God will still accept us if we just repent. But you only accept us if we're in his body. How do we get in his body? First, have to hear the word. We have to hear how he came down, taught many people, laid down his doctrine, died on the cross, and then resurrected from the grave, and then and came up to heaven. And what he left when he died was the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is what you get when you follow through the rest of these steps. So once you hear the word, you then have to believe it with all your heart, mind, and soul. And then once you believe it, that will then force you to repent. If you truly believe what Jesus has said, the repentant part is not going to be that hard. Because if you believe what he says, you know that repentance is more than worth it. And then once you repent, meaning make the change in your life, then you can confess before your brothers and sisters that you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And after you confess, nothing stops you from getting down in the water and getting the baptism. I encourage you, if you're not a part of his body, to get in. Like I said, this life is nothing but a vapor. And we don't know what our last hour is. So the opportunity is right now. Don't let go of this opportunity. Because if you die, you're going to be more than sorry if you didn't take advantage of this. But also, I encourage people who are in the body to come down and confess. confess your sins before one another, ask for prayer if you need it. We're all in need of prayer. But I encourage you, don't let the fear of being judged, don't let the fear of being looked at when you walk down be the thing that keeps you from asking for prayer, because the prayers of the righteous are better than much. So out of all people in this building, if one person has a good prayer that reaches God, your request will be heard. The value that is in this room through prayer is much more valuable than your own pride. So I encourage you to come down as we sing this conversation.
Hello and welcome to the Eastside Church of Christ. This afternoon I will be coming out of Genesis chapter 13 when God told Abraham to walk through the land that was promised to him. And we'll examine what that's all about this evening. I hope you enjoy it.
Go see. scripture for this afternoon. We'll be covering the book of Genesis. Those who like to follow along, we'll begin reading the 13th chapter of the book of Genesis. And we'll start at verse 14, remember 13 and 14. And it reads as follows. And the Lord said unto Abraham, or Abram, after that Lot was separated from him, lift up now thine eyes and look from the place where thou art northward and southward and eastward and westward. For all the land which thou seest, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed forever. And I will make thy seed as the dust of the earth, so that if a man can number the dust of the earth, then shall he thy seed also be numbered. Arise, walk through the land, in the length of it, and in the breadth of it, for I will give it unto thee. May the Lord our blessing to the ears and doers of his holy divine word.
I chapter 194. And all to me,
Thank you.
got it, man. You got it.
Could it be that
you're not walking through it, and you're not working through it, so you can't really appreciate it for what it is. So, God has given us, each and every one of us, our individual purpose. He's given us gifts. He's given us different traits that are unique to us. And with that comes a unique purpose. And with that purpose comes a task to fulfill that purpose. And a lot of us are looking around trying to find different ways and different things to fill this void. When God has given us a purpose, and He's telling you to walk through that purpose, but if we just shy away from it. A lot of us might not even know what our purpose is. And so that I simply tell you to stay in the Word and recognize and see where you see parallels. See where God is going to do in your life. Because some special things happen when you read the Word. I know it's easy for me to get up here and tell you to read the Word and everything will work out, but I'm telling you. Things work out when you allow God in your life and when you read the Word. And so for those who feel like they don't have a purpose or their gifts can't be used in the church, I challenge you to read the Word. I challenge you to get to know God. I challenge you to try to see where you fit in, because I promise you, you do. Even if it's some little thing, even if it's some little thing, it may be little to us, but it's really big to God, because you're doing what you need to do.
Right.
I encourage you to find that thing. And for us, for some, I was one of these for a while. We know what gifts we have, and we know kind of like the purpose that we've been given, but we shy away from it. Because either whether it be for fear of rejection or fear that you might fall short or just crumbling under pressure.
Yeah.
A lot of times for myself, if I can just be real with y'all, I'm gonna say, there's a lot of pressure. I feel a lot of pressure to get up here and speak to you all, because I want to do so much. I want to change lives. Like, I want to bring people to Christ. And so when I get up here, it's a lot of weight that I feel on my shoulders. But then I remember that God is with me. Then I remember that the Spirit of God, I mean, it's not even me up here talking, it's the Spirit, so I just let Him take over.
Okay.
And so what I'm saying, I say that to say, in your life, there are times, in order for you to fulfill your purpose and to walk in your purpose, you have to let the Spirit take over.
Amen.
You have to allow God to speak through you, because it's not you that's speaking. Because all you are is a vessel to deliver the Spirit to somebody else.
Amen.
To deliver the kingdom to somebody else. And so then through you, they can see God.
Mm-hmm.
And so I encourage you to walk through your promise and through your purpose. But what about the promise? Jesus said, "In my house there are many mansions."
Mm-hmm.
If it was not so, I would have told you.
Mm-hmm.
What about the promise? That He promised all of us Christians.
Amen.
What about that? Are we walking in that promise? No, like really, are we really working in that promise? Are we really walking in it? Do we really exude it? Do we really give off that aura that something's promised for me? This life isn't it. Are people seeing that in us? Or are they seeing someone that's a prisoner of the moment?
Right.
Are they seeing somebody who's just trying to get by? I just want you to think about that. And I want you to think about how you can walk in that purpose, which is through the life that you live. Through the way that you carry yourself, through the way that you talk to others. You can tell somebody who's walking in the promise of God through the way they speak, through their speech, through the way they talk. They carry themselves a different way. They carry themselves in a way that they know that this is it. Other people are walking around frantically looking because I need to get what I can get while I'm here. But we know, us that are walking in the promise or trying to walk in the promise, that there's something else promised for us. So I encourage you to walk in that promise and to realize that something is promised for us on the other side. Something is waiting for us on the other side. I know we feel like at times it's nothing else. Like, is there more? Like, we look around in our life and we're not satisfied. Like, is there more? Is there more to life than going to work, coming back, and saying hi to the kids and going to sleep?
Yeah.
Is there more? Yes, there is more.
Right.
So I encourage you all to recognize the promise and to walk in that promise, the link. The breadth of it, so you can really see the full magnitude of what God has given to us, both in your purpose and in the promise that He gave us, which is heaven. So I thank you all at this time. If there are some of you who are still in need of prayer, because that's all of us, if some of you who are in need of prayer, who realize that you're not really walking, that you're not really doing all that you could, come down and we'll pray for you and we'll encourage you and we'll be with you throughout this process. Make sure that you get that.
out.